entire team in the way that they draft. They're not so worried about the meta drafts.
And this is where the decision comes out. Do you ban the Wisp or do you ban the Lycan?
Yep. Has to be the Lycan.
I would ban the Lycan, yeah.
Yep.
Yeah, they're going to ban the Lycan.
Yeah.
And instead they go for the Lifestealer. Okay.
And that would make sense.
Yep. Bit of a change up.
Okay. So if you're going to go crazy game one, right, Charlie?
Oh, well, crazy.
Test it.
No, I don't.
Throw something at them.
No, I don't necessarily think. I don't think you go too crazy game one. Maybe throw a wrench at them at like last pick or something.
Yeah.
Don't go too crazy, but give them a different look and see how they react.
Okay. Yeah. See what they do. Picks one and two.
Now, I think Liquid, with the Lifestealer open, they're going to go with one of the sort of the more standard, stable opens. A lot, like, my favorite opens right now are probably some combination of Lifestealer, Beastmaster, and Lion.
Yep. I completely agree with you. So
And the odds are pretty good that they'll get one of those.
Right. Yep. We'll probably see Complexity take, I think, the Beastmaster, but they don't really play it too often, right?
Yeah, I don't think you can leave that on the table is the big problem.
No.
I don't think you can let Liquid open. I mean, we saw in the last series, Fnatic allowed the Lifestealer Beastmaster open and beat
because
it.
Because they had something ready for it with the Terra Blade.
Exactly. Yeah. But at the same time, I think when you look at all the things that Fnatic had to do at an incredibly high level to beat that open, I'm just not going to give it away.
Explain to those that aren't familiar with the drafts and don't watch a lot of Dota is that these teams, and I know Kyle in particular, spends ages mock drafting and working out, if we do this and ban that, what would they pick? And we think they would pick this and we would pick that. What would that give us later on? They do these things all the time.
Yeah, and that should be standard practice across all teams.
Yep.
You should absolutely mock draft. Find somebody that really thinks like the other team and just practice drafting against each other.
I heard Blitz talking about this with Liquid as well. So
yeah, this
he's great for that.
I believe, like,
I really like this.
Yeah, I do too. Mm-hmm. I do too. This is a hero that's really Dazzle come back into the first phase. It's kind of similar to how we saw some teams try out Shadow Demon. This has come back into the meta largely because it's so good against Lifesteal. It's also very good against Death Prophet, which is another staple of Liquid.
Yeah, we were just actually like talking to Melon just before, and he's like, points right at that when somebody else picks it versus Lifestealer, so definitely not a surprise.
Really good at those teams that heavily focus on killing one single hero to start off a fight, and Dazzle counteracts that completely.
Yep. And so this is interesting. Liquid borrowing very heavily from some of the Chinese teams. This has been a little bit rare in this tournament to see the Western teams focusing on Tidehunter in the first phase.
Yeah, in the past, I think what you've seen from a lot of high-level Western teams is that they've shied away from Tidehunter. They don't really like playing it because it makes you it makes your entire team fight focused on that Tidehunter ultimate. You feel like you can't fight if it's on cooldown, and so you. Every time it's on cooldown, you just give ground away to the other team, and you're slowly losing map control because Tidehunter ultimate's up. You feel like you can't fight, so you just concede more and more ground.
Right, that was the focus kind of when we were talking about the meta at Epicenter. The focus of the discussion was cooldown reliant lineups versus skirmish lineups.
Yep.
But this is the thing, when you're Liquid, when you're this good at setting up these trades, they're going to get value out of that Ravage.
Yep, absolutely. And seeing these bans, it's nothing outside the box. You know, we've been seeing a lot of the Ricky Lifestealer, especially in particular versus Beastmaster, and I feel like that pertains to, of course, the Invis Infest ganks. Of course, Hawk won't really notice it. It's great at just finding those quick pickoffs. And the Drow ban, you know, you pretty much have to ban that third, fourth versus Complexity.
Yeah, this really, Complexity really trying to keep the option of that four position Beastmaster alive, right? This is not, they've been avoiding junglers recently, but the Ricky and the Bounty Hunter bans tell me that they at least want the option going forward in the draft to have that Beastmaster on Z-Freak running in the jungle.
Yeah, I agree. This is something that we've seen out of the previous series was that the Ricky pick against Newbie really threw them for a loop, and it completely shut down so many of their cores and so many of their options. They don't want to, Complexity does not want to give Liquid that ability to really mess up their lanes here.
At the same time, they are absolutely baiting the Wisp pick here.
Oh yeah, but I do think that Complexity is probably going to go for what, like either the Death Prophet or maybe even the Chessy Invoker? We haven't really gotten a chance to see that.
Yeah, it felt to me for a while like they lost a little bit of faith in the Chessy Invoker. He had been doing so well on a mid. I would love to see them pick up Tiny for Limp. I feel like Tiny is like Limp's best hero by a wide margin. I think Limp might be the top Tiny player in the world.
It's into Lifestealer though?
They come for Doom.
The Doom, yeah.
So it is coming.
Very stable.
Okay.
And this is, it's a nice option to have right now, because you've actually, as Complexity, you've given away almost no information about how your lanes are going to look this early.
Yeah, that could be a four position Doom, that could be a three position Doom. Both Swindles and Z-Freak can play either one of those heroes.
And I also like the Disruptor pick by Team Liquid. It's a little bit of a block pick.
Block pick, yeah,
right?
Exactly.
Because it's so good against the Tidehunter.
Yeah, and the Doom as well, for Complexity, it's very good versus the Lifestealer, it's very good versus the Tidehunter. He has multiple options of Dooming targets.
There's the DP.
And now, they do go for the DP, it gives them a little, it gives them a lot more physical damage, which they already have the Weave and the Beastmaster, so they have more push, and it gives them, of course, another a big teamfight ultimate, which they were kind of lacking.
And something that we've seen with Death Prophets that have lost in past series is that she dies because she gets bursted down real quickly. Yep. When she gets initiated on, she just, that's like half your damage. And there's no way to save her, but Complexity has drafted the Dazzle to keep the Death Prophet alive. And that's like, that's huge. Now, if Death Prophet picks up a Yule's, she gets a Grave, there's ways to ensure that even if she gets gone on, she doesn't die immediately.
Yeah, similar, very similar to the way that they were able to use the Oracle against Wings yesterday. I like the Death Prophet pickup. I think, you know, Liquid are going to be looking for their cores, obviously, in the last two picks. This is one of the advantages of having Fata and Matu both very flexible hero pools.
Yeah, they do. So they're probably looking at what Kuroki's hero, so they can at least hide what Fata plays, unless they want to just choose straight up what he's going to play versus the Death Prophet. But
I might pick Fata's hero now, because there's always the worry, because Complexity has already revealed their hand. There's no point in waiting for the mid pick.
Fair enough.
And you run the risk of getting what you want banned out.
So what would you like for Fata here?
Ooh. So he needs a Lifestealer needs a reliable delivery system here.
Right.
There is the Puck, but then you're running single core Lifestealer, and we haven't seen that go very well at all.
Wait, what about single core Lifestealer, Charlie?
Hey, guess what, guy? Guess what's really bad? Single core Lifestealer. But there is the option of the Queen of Pain. Oh,
wow, this is something.
Okay. So let's rack for Liquid. So it's Liquid that kind of.
Well, the question,
throwing
right?
A spanner here.
The question is this mid Lushrak or is this four Lushrak?
Has to be mid, right?
I'm not really sure. I think
this is a deliberate.
This could be a mid Lushrak, but I think
if I had to bet, it would be support.
Like mid Lushrak is so bad against Doom and Beastmaster and.
Well,
it's such a dangerous pick here.
It does pull the spells onto the Leshrac, though, then rather than the Lifestealer, which I guess you could look at as interesting.
What do you want?
What a liquid ban here, though.
If he tanks, if he tanks up, you doom him with Pulse Nova, and Pulse Nova keeps going, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, so, I mean, your Leshrac is doing something.
It really depends on. Really depends on timing, right? If you just doom the Leshrac before he gets any spells off.
By the way, they think it is going to be
the Tusk. Which is what a Tusk,
I think it probably will as well. I think Disruptor Leshrac.
That's actually clever.
That's smart.
Yeah. Just in case. I think Disruptor Leshrac supports are really weak, so. Or, not exactly weak, but. They're both heroes are incredibly level dependent and would be really greedy. 10 seconds, right? S4 would be proud here. And Kuroki trying to make mid Leshrac work.
They've played the Leshrac before, but they did put in the safe lane. I think it was safe lane for Fata, one of the games, and they put something else mid. And we've been seeing people adjust a lot in this tournament, like throwing pretty odd lanes. Like we've been seeing like offlane Lifestealer with a support hero. We've been seeing like we need our Tidehunter to have a good game or something. We're gonna put him short lane and do some like pseudo aggro, and we have a big changeup. So I think that's actually what we might see.
Wow. And I wondered if Complexity were gonna take this hero, because it's sort of it's not obviously similar to Wisp, but it can fulfill some of the same roles in terms of dual laning early. It's been primarily played recently in SEA, but it's still among the top five elo shift per game heroes in this patch. It's very, very strong. Of course, it was super strong early before the mini nerf.
So they probably want to pick up a carry hero, maybe even a lone druid. It fits their entire dynamic of pushing, and it does sound like a Complexity hero, of course, because it gets weeped up and everything. Not the best versus the Lifestealer, of course, because, you know, Feast does stack up, but when you have Weave, it does make quite a big difference. And Root is, you know, Root and Savage Roar.
Root counters Lifestealer, and they have run Lone Druid Death Prophet a lot.
I'm a big fan of Lone Druid because it's autonomous, but they're going to go with the Chessie Juggernaut. I was mainly concerned that they get a stable hero for Chessie in lane. I think this fits the bill quite nicely. I like this draft from Cole.
I actually really like this draft from Cole a lot. The healing ward is great. The Juggernaut is great against every single one of Team Liquid's heroes, actually.
Yeah. I told you they had a plan.
Yeah, I really do. I really
I didn't doubt that. I didn't doubt that they had a plan, but can they play above their range? That's the question.
Well, we're going to find out because we're going to head over to our commentators now. For game number one, here is Wagga and OD Pixel.
Thank you very much, Paul. Indeed, we're ready to get stuck into Liquid versus Complexity. Are you looking forward to this one, Wagga?
I am. It feels like Complexity are going for push strat again as well. They're picking up the Juggernaut, adding some push to the DP. I am looking forward to this.
All right. Well, let's not wait about here as we get ourselves into game one of Liquid versus Complexity. Prepare for battle. Here we have it indeed, ladies and gentlemen. So, well, as we get ourselves through with the rundowns, Wagga, talk to me about the two drafts. We've heard what the panel has to say. Do you agree with what they're saying, or is there anything you really want to pick up on here?
I just think that it's sort of all in by Complexity. You need to go, even if Juggernaut scales pretty well, Beastmaster's sometimes okay, it feels like Liquid actually themselves had a greedy Beastmaster game earlier where they got punished later on the game because it takes so much of the farm away from your actual course. Whereas Liquid, they just have the Frost Armor, the synergy with Lifesteer. We have seen so much Lifesteer at this tournament, and he does quite well, even in the late game.
And yeah, you know, just seeing this hero kind of getting picked up lots of times in the first pick phase of the draft. A hero that's kind of seemed to be a bit of a flavor with just very specific teams, the Leshrac. You know, sometimes we've seen Alliance, S4, we know he likes to draft it. Liquid, they're bringing it out here again. I believe they've already done so this tournament. But what's your thoughts on Lesh this patch? Because it's certainly not something that every team is on board with.
No, definitely not. I think they just picked something that can defend against the push quite well. Granted, they do have the Ravage, they do have the Static Storm follow-up, so that's pretty decent, but they need more D push, and that's where the Wave Flare from Fada on the Leshrac is going to be pretty nice. Interesting as well, they pick Leshrac against another team that plays Lesh, but they play it as support. Zed Freak actually plays it on Complexity. But we'll see how it goes on the mid lane, already getting a deny from the Lich, so getting quite a bit of help there.
And it's going to be interesting to see as well how much support presence we do see remain around the mid lane. I mean, if you're Kuroki, do you stick around with the Lesh to help out against the DP? I mean, how long are we going to see this kind of stairs of 2v1?
I don't think you should. I don't think it's needed. After denying the first range creep, maybe you can stick around for a second one, 30 seconds until it's off cooldown. But top lane, they can't really fight now against this dual lane. Just Juggernaut and Dazzle are going to be quite strong together.
Yeah, I mean, this lane situation that we found both the teams in, the fact that we've got Chessie up on the top lane farming on the Jug, and you put Swindles on the bottom lane on the Beast solo against the Tide. Who's this favoring here? Who's going to be happier with this lane situation?
I think Complexity are a little bit happier, but it's not good for Limp that he's taking so much harassment on mid lane here, and we've seen him before just destroy a lane on his own. So maybe this is just Liquid going, hey, if we can slow down the DP's item progression and levels early on, that's really gonna make mid game easier. But yeah, this Tide against Beastmaster is gonna have a good time.
We see top lane as well, just both sides really kind of going in at each other mid.
That's the third in a row, actually, that Fada missed. Having a hard time.
It's a zoning stun. It's a zoning.
Oh yeah. Yeah, I mean, he is zoned for sure.
And suddenly the moment, 6-2 against the 4-0. Slight edge for Fada. We can see there's a bit of aggressive jungling here from Z-Freak as he comes over into the most half of the map of Liquids. And not a lot really that they're going to be doing about this, especially with the way that Kuroki's playing. You know, he does seem pretty set on just staying in the mid lane, causing as much issues as he can for Limp.
There's really not much Lich can do in terms of roaming as well, so probably fine for him just to try and find a lane to stay on. I would like to see him switch now, because staying too long on mid lane is not really good. But Set Freak, as you said, farming up and trying to get that level 3. With the Bounty Rune, actually will get it. So Scorched Earth is up now.
Oh, see if he's able to look for any kind of action towards the top lane. He is going to head over and join the rest of the crew of Complexity, and we'll see if they can find anything top. Eyes onto Jerax, so they can lead him with the Poison Dust Mask, and it's a great heal bomb as well, and that's your first blood there.
That's a nice little combo, actually.
Yeah, with the skeletons out, a lot of units to get that heal bounce off. And now Z3, yeah, as you said, getting the good timing on the level 3 and making a play like that, a great start for Complexity this game.
It speeds up the item progression for Doom so much as well, getting that first blood. When you're juggling Doom like this, you already farm quite fast, and now you can have even more.
1100 gold in his pocket, and we're before the 3-minute mark, just thanks to the play and thanks to that kill.
I think he just goes full Tranquils. Yep, he picks it up immediately. I think this is going to be very easy for him now to start roaming, and they don't have the best heroes when he gets close to them. Doom has that run into your face kind of style, and Lich doesn't do that well when Doom is on top.
Bottom lane, look at the CS at the moment between Swindles and Mind Control. 13 for 2, 19 for 2, so Mind Control certainly having the preferential lane for the time being.
It's a very easy lane for Tidehunter, to be fair, and Beastmaster can still farm there, but he's not going to get the same amount of farm.
And of course, talking about the farm as well, up on the top lane, still a lead here for the Lifestealer. The Timberman hasn't been slowed down too much by the presence of this aggressive kind of combination that Carl are running against him. So
I think the bigger part, though, is the Complexity are getting experience up here, and they're not really risking dying. Unless Hanskin goes out of position, he's going to be just fine.
Crook, he's going to head over, but of course, they do have vision of this movement, Complexity, with the ward. Eyes onto Chessie. And also a wraparound as well from behind from Z3. We'll see if he's able to kick off anything here. Onto Jarax, but Kuroki just forcing him back here with the blast. Not really a lot that Liquid can do about this Doom in terms of trying to bring him down.
They get the D ward, but it was about to run out anyway, and he has one more ward that he can place out soon. Getting scouted actually by the ward of the Dire as he heads towards mid.
And on top lane, that's a moment. Just trading hits here with Chessie. They're kind of playing on the edge. The Timberman just making sure that they can zone him back. And as we can see, Kuroki now sitting up top. It's a little bit more of a trickier lane now for Complexity.
This is what I want to see, just him shutting down this lane a little bit, because mid should be fine no matter what. Leshrac does quite well on his own.
And we'll see Z3 is going to be coming in from the sidelines. Him, the Timberman already trying to go really aggressive onto Chessie on the sidelines. Z3 already chasing down Jarax. Chessie's trying to come in to help out as well. The kinetic field will hold Complexity back. The Timberman looking towards the Doom. Open wounds as well. They'll chase down Z3 with a Thunderstrike on him as well. He's going to follow. Can they get him out? Dead. No, he's gone down. Liquid now going to look to see if they can get themselves a second. Eyes onto Hansken. Chessie trying to do his best to hold the Timberman back. Coming in hard with the crits. Chessie incredibly low. He's going to go back in over the blade, but they'll find it. They'll take down the Timberman in return. So one for one at the moment.
Underestimating the Dazzle a little bit there, and they have to pay. Meanwhile, solo HP on Swindles getting chased.
My goodness, this man, he needs to be careful. He has got Z3 to help him out here, and he'll get himself killed. Walks into the troll camp.
He has to deny himself there. Still a pretty short death time, even though he's level 6. But that top engagement there, losing the Lifestealer, that hurts a little bit.
Yeah, not the trade that Liquid were looking for sure. And the Lifestealer for the Doom trade.
And I don't think that the Doom had the best creep coming into that gank. Just the toughness aura, yes, extra armor is pretty nice, but he also had 200 mana that he couldn't use. If he had something like a clap, a stomp, or even just a troll with the end snare, that would have gone to kill there, as the Juggernaut could have caught. And he does switch it to a troll now.
And worth noting as well, it's going to be put a bit of stopper on the actions from Mind Control, as he did actually use the Ravage to try for that kill that we saw. Of course, he didn't get a Swindles managed to deny himself, so. But it was slow down in pace for him there. Z3 eyes onto Fada, but Lesh will get to grab the Arcane. That's a great room for farming the mid lane up.
It truly is. It's really great if there's ever a fight as well. Such low cooldowns on the stun for Split.
There might be a fight. I mean, looking at Complexity, Hanskin smoke will be dispelled. Jarek's on the high ground. They actually got their eyes on towards the mid lane. Z3 coming in as well. I mean, let's see how much this could do for Fada having an Arcane rune. They're not going to do anything again. These field bombs from Hanskin. Destroying the members of Liquid, and immediately Complexity, they get their push on four heroes mid with the Exorcism up as well.
They're actually bringing the fifth as well.
Let's see what Liquid could do to try and stop it, and I think they've just got to kind of sit back and watch this one go down. Frostarm are not going to do too much in terms of slowing this push from Complexity, as they'll be sure to take the tier one. And Liquid, I mean, at the moment they didn't bring everyone in, you know, there is a bit of space for Mutumberman on the top lane on his Lifestealer.
Yeah, you can't fight that, not without the Ravage, as he used it earlier to get the Beastmaster killed.
Fada just coming back in, zoning Limp back, but Complexity at the moment, 3-for-1. They've got to be happy with the way that this game's starting, but of course the upside for Liquid, the fact that Mutumberman, he's having a very nice game up on the top lane, apart from going down early on. He's keeping up in terms of farm, second on the board as well, so You know, we can certainly expect to see him have the beginnings of a good life stealer game at the moment.
Second on the board in net worth, but actually Liquid are far ahead when it comes to CS. They're topping the charts quite heavily as the Beastmaster, or the Lifesteer and Tidehunter are farming so much. So yes, you lost the tower, but if you later on can return a tower trade, then
on
you're
top
be good.
They're actually making a go by the looks of it onto Schwindles. He's left alone here in Liquid. They should have a good chance of taking this man down, and they'll get it with the Infest damage. It's Summerman. Claims himself a kill, so the man that we're talking about having a nice time, a nice kind of quiet lane, is at a complexity we're looking for action elsewhere, now getting a kill as well.
Lifesteer is just so strong. So strong in the laning stage, he can always look for kills with his supports. Doesn't take much to bring it. Bada.
I'll see what I can do with this one. He has got a double damage, but Limp.
Hard to chase, siphon. Though.
Yeah, in fact, Limp, yeah, he kind of wired that one up, wondering if he had the chance of turning that one around, but...
Yeah, just a slow from a Spirit Siphon. You can't keep chasing, you can't keep the Diabolic Edict hitting him. It's gonna be hard.
This top, we might actually see... Unless the complexity is just coming up here to stop Liquid from continuing to put pressure onto this tower.
These wards are a little bit awkward from Liquid, by the way, on the top lane. They actually dropped two Observer wards in the same area, and they're quite pretty much the same timers, just 1 minute in between.
Quite weird indeed. I mean,
a little bit of a misplay.
Well, Swindles has got that roar available, but again, he's kind of been left up here on his own. He needs to be incredibly careful. We saw him very low here.
Yeah, I would like to see him a little bit more in the jungle and just smoking whenever needed and going for ganks, because on this offlane, he can't really do that much, and he's such an easy pickoff as well. And they're going for the bottom now.
Yeah, look at this. Here we have it. Chessie moving in onto the side. Mind control pops the Ravage here. It's a good Ravage, but not really any kind of follow-up until... Oh, Kuroki comes in, but the bounces are not going to be preferential. Tide will get taken down. Chessie even trying to eye up another one. So the bounces continues to go. Chessie getting himself incredibly low here, but Kuroki can't quite get himself in to get that final blast out as the backup of Complexity is there. And on Swindles, he'll turn, get the roar through, and there will be TPs coming in to help him. So Timberman needs to be a little bit careful. Already a glimpse back onto one.
Does have the infests. No mana for Doom right now. He's just a few mana points away. Got it now. But of course, they see both the Beastmaster and the Doom, so not much they can catch here, I think.
Timberman still hanging around on this top lane. Does continue to have the backup of the Disruptor. But at this point in the game, 10 minutes in, 4 for 2, it's not been the highest action in terms of kills. And still, Mutumaman does lie at the top of that graph in terms of the net worth.
Both teams are really ready, though. You see both teams just gathering up the items needed, getting the farm to later on start pushing towers. And I think it's really important for Complexity that they don't just mindlessly push, but actually take the time to get some items on Juggernaut, because he had not the best early game, and it's quite needed that he has the farm to really dive in with his ulti.
Bottom lane, talking about the Jug Chessie. Looks like he's kind of being respected a lot by Liquid. They did have two down here, but not going to look for anything aggressive. Just backing away. He's trying to give a bit of lane XP, by the looks of it, potentially to Kuroki. He's just going to come down with the lane down here on the bottom. He has got the ult back up in 20 seconds. But yeah, they're all just very split up at the moment across the map, and no kind of big grouping up as of yet to look for the big plays. I mean, they're waiting on these key times, timings on the items, like Mind Control. Nearly got the mechanism.
And he's preparing the big Ancient stack as well, so that's going to give him a nice boost of gold. And this is what we see from pretty much every Tide and Enigma in this tournament. It's just the mana boots into mech, just go for that Guardian Greaves early.
Look at this smoke as well.
To smoke up.
I mean, they know that Liquid are here with this ward. They know the exact position.
They're going to smoke into each other here.
Oh, and they are going to have the high ground advantage in Complexity, but Liquid immediately is going to be dispelled, so they know that something's up.
You do not want to walk up there.
Mind control, Ravage in 5 seconds. At the moment, it's just both. He's fanning each other off. Z3, very small glimpse, getting him brought back on the side. They're going to run to Fada. Fada quite out on his own, on the sidelines, away from the rest of his team. And Complexity, they take a free kill onto a core.
Yeah, that's why Complexity really wanted to go there, but they were not grouped up. And it's almost impossible to walk in there. Tide tries to walk in, he can always get doomed, and then you will not have a Ravage for a big team fight. And they're probably going to lose two towers on the back of this.
But the Exorcism only just popped. There's no reason for Complexity to hold back a TP. Already coming in from Kuroki.
Frost Armor is there to try and slow down the progress here, but I mean, I don't think you defend this. They're trying to wrap around. They actually smoke again.
Yeah, they do still have that Ravage. Vada's now back in. Liquid. See what they can find here. Straight away with the Daddy's on the Ravage, but it's only onto one. They will be able to find Z-Freak. And Glimpse back, bringing Swindles into the middle of the building. He's just going to go for the TP straight out, but the Chain Frost is there with the mini stuns. They cancel it. Swindles will fall as well. So Liquid finding themselves too. That was the back of this defense.
That was a great smoke around, and they also get a good initiation there, realizing they have to use a lot to kill off the Doom before he just counters the Tide.
A nice hold there from Liquid, and we'll see how much of a push they want to get on down in this bottom lane, try and find a tier 1 for themselves for the first time so far this game.
Tide will TP top though, and there is Limp hanging around, but he has been spotted by these wards. The double wards, we made fun of it earlier, it's working.
It's working out indeed, it's an extra bit of vision. As you said, eyes onto Limp. And in terms of Limp's build as well, he's starting to save the money. Are we going to see the Yules first? Is this a man who likes to go for kind of that bit of a newer build with the Veil?
Oh, definitely Veil. I think Veil into Yules is going to be the build every time on the current patch.
Bottom lane, Liquid were able to finish off the tier 1. Still up top, Complexity. Also eyes on a potential kill as well, as we can see. At the moment, Tide all on his own. He'll be playing it safe, and he needs to. Complexity, they have the full 5-man now moving up onto Liquid's half of the map hit.
And Complexity are really starting to gain momentum. Even if they lost 2 here at bottom, they're not scared. They're going to keep pressuring, keep taking more towers. And I think Liquid really have to go for this Ancient stack right away. Tidehunter needs to clear this because you don't know how much longer you're going to control this part of the map. Yeah.
One more stack and that'll be ready to go. But as you said, they do have that ward on the Hydra Complex, so they know exactly that this is going to be happening. So it'll be interesting to see if they are able to contest the Ancients.
I don't think so. I think they just take the tier 2 tower here and they're going to be pretty happy with that. They also just popped the Exorcism, so maybe they can keep pushing and just force a TP.
But this is going to be really big for Mind Control if he gets away with this one scot-free. If Complexity don't interrupt him at all, then he gets away with this huge cash and experience influx that's going to put him very close, if not right next to having that gold ready for the Blink Dagger on top of his mechanism, and should put him near to, well, yeah, should put him definitely to level 11. There we have it. So, Ravage back up in 20 seconds.
And as we see the game progress, Complexity are 5-manning a lot. That's what they drafted for, but that's always going to result in your team falling behind in experience. The gold, quite even. You're taking a lot of towers. Complexity has to be slightly ahead, but experience, that's where we really see, you know, the painful results of 5-manning too much. But they need to do it. They need to take down towers and control the map, get one Aegis, and then just go.
Yeah, and I mean, talking about the timing as well, you know, 15 minutes in, you've taken 3 tier 1s and a tier 2. Is that at the pace that Complexity would have expected to run, or is it going faster or slower than they needed to?
No, I think it's definitely the expected pace trying to go, but it's going to be a little bit hard to catch Swindles.
It's a good glimpse, though, straight into the follow-up sun. Swindles blown up by the side of Liquid. No reaction from the rest of Complexity. You can see just keeping the push on in the mid lane, top lane as well, being forced in just by a DP illusion, but Complexity, they weren't looking to fight that at all down there. They kind of just offered up Swindles for free.
Yes, but Liquid are looking to fight mid though. They want to take a fight here as they know Beastmaster is dead, wrapping around. But they're going to back out, so they successfully defend their tier 2 tower, barely sustain any damage onto it, and bottom tower is gone now.
Mind Control very, very close to the Blink. In fact, well, this camp will give it to him.
He got that money so fast. Just 1 minute ago, he was like 500 gold.
Yeah, pretty much. I mean, that stat gave him a straight kind of 1,400, 1,500 gold.
Yep.
Well, indeed, and an easy clear level on the man. So, level 11 Ravage at the ready.
And they get the point booster now onto Leshrac. Leshrac hasn't had the best game. Vada starting at 0, 2, and 2. And Leshrac is very much a momentum-based hero, same as DP. Both these heroes can definitely fall if you get ganked a few times.
Manu's farm is still, of course, good. Is Mutumba Man's on the Lifestealer. Still at the top, a clear 1,200 ahead of Chessy on the Juggernaut.
Can he stay alive here, Swindles? They're looking for him again, but
he's
got to
be careful. I mean, it's been a few times that he has been caught out by the side of Liquid, and they do have that ward down, so they know his exact whereabouts.
I'm actually amazed how much farm Kuroki has gathered up. He has 1,700 gold right now on his Lich, so he could pick up a Gold Scepter if he wants to, pretty good against the Juggernauts, or just a 4-step, which a lot of teams have been going for, a lot of 4-steps.
He's going to walk into this one straight away. Jarek's reacting with the Statics on the top, the Chain Frost as well, one bounce off the board and it'll be enough. Liquid punishing Z-Freak there as he feels that he's going to be walking back into the safety of his own jungle. That certainly wasn't the case. Mind Control just warding Swindles away from that area. And Fud already looking to set up something mid. This could be a nice wraparound here if they can catch someone. Chessy, he's been hanging around, hitting away this tier 2 for quite a while. And
very hard to catch a Juggernaut, though.
Yeah. Straight out with the Blade Fury TP. Nothing that Liquid can do at this stage of the game to stop that one.
Yeah, he's going to go away. And they were looking to set up on Death Prophet. Limp. They had a ward and saw him. Actually, the glimpse.
Yeah, it's going to allow them to get the range here for this slow from the lining. The open wounds as well. Here we go. Swindles hit the roll for the stun. Oh, the follow grabbing the catch too. Swindles down and now looking for Chessy. Chessy, he plays way around this one. He'll pop the Omnis. That's now Cobble. Who can turn him? A Dribble Man will fall on. He'll go down. Now the Spirit Cypher chasing down more with the Blade Fury as well as the second one. But the side of Complexity and Mind Control. Can he get himself away, Chessy? Hands going looking to chase him. Can he get the Dukes off? Yes, he will. Blinks off to the west. Mind Control will survive. So they lose Swindles, but Complexity with a nice reaction there to what looked like a great initiation from Liquid. The two-man stun from Fudder, followed up by Mind Control's Ravage. But it wasn't enough for them to win the fight. They lose more heroes and they lose a tier 2.
Complexity, they have so good counter initiation. That's the thing. It was a really good stun by Leshrac and they tried to commit because of that, but ended up losing their Lifesteer and Leshrac because of this. Doombringer, Dazzle, these are just strong counter initiations. And we really saw Limp just run into the center of that fight. The Veil and Spirit Siphon, it's truly powerful.
Absolutely, at this stage of the game, just ripped through the lineup of Liquid.
And he's going VKB on this Death Prophet, yeah. Not the Yule Scepter build.
I mean, that's so, you look at Liquid's lineup, oh, and then yeah. It's pretty much what just Matumba Man that can even dream of doing anything for a BKB.
It's going to be a really strong item here. Chessy, though, the one that went for Vanguard and his Juggernaut, trying to catch up and get the Battle Fury going. Make sure you have something for a late game as well, as they're trying to take many towers.
I mean, as we saw there already, you know, Fanscan lays down a good weave into the Omni Slash. It does enough damage as it is, so, you know, by no means is this going to sack the potential of Chessy at this stage. I mean, even things like the Blade Fury, thanks for the Veil of Discord, it's going to do so much against Liquid's lineup at this stage if they do get caught off guard like that. But Liquid, going to stay strong and move in again onto the mid lane. See what kind of reaction Complexity you want to go for. They've been very careful about choosing when to react to Liquid. You know, we've seen them a lot of times just let Liquid get away with a free tower and just continue to find stuff elsewhere on them.
There's just too many cooldowns right now on Complexity. Doom still 30 seconds, 30 seconds for Exorcism, and just now the Omnislash is just cooling down, so this tower definitely going down. And that allows Liquid to go in and plant some deep wards as well. But, you know, Complexity, they're splitting up. Zetfreak is pushing in mid top lane again.
Yeah, it's going in rather deep as well in the complex. They do know still that some of Liquid are hanging around with this scan. They know that they're here in the side, hiding in the trees. So Z-Freak feeling confident to continue to get this space. Got 1900 gold as well. I mean, what do you expect him to be getting? Oh, I think he might be getting caught out. That's what it could be here with Liquid's rotation through the smoke. Heading into the jungle, we'll see who they can find. Z-Freak would be a nice one. When I last checked, he did have a fair bit of gold in his pocket as well.
He still does. Yeah. He could be going for a Vladimir's. If Defensive Beastmaster wants to pick it up, but since Beast is building Necrobooks, it should be a Vlad's on the...
And he's doom. Been lucky with this as well. And Limp. Limp.
They see him.
Limp.
He wants to farm, but...
This man is so, so dead here, getting caught out. Very unfortunate movement from Limp there. I mean, he did come, but he did feel that he was safe because obviously he got this Observer Ward, but obviously with the smoke, Liquid managed to wrap around and Limp just did not expect to find the full lineup of Liquid there waiting for him on the high ground.
Such an ultra sad time to die as well. He had 1200 gold. He was so close to a recipe for the BKB, and he does already have a Mithril Hammer, so would have completed it. That's going to delay the timing of Complexity a little bit more. And they can't really push the last tier 2 tower or start breaking high ground until they have completed this BKB. So, really good by Liquid.
As we can see, you know, obviously Z-Freak, on the plus side for him, he didn't get caught. He's got 2.1k. I mean, is it going to be the Vlad's? Is there any reason why this man would opt for like an initiation item like the Blink or the Shadow Blade against Liquid's lineup instead?
You could go for it. It would allow him to try and catch out the Tide a little bit more easily and also force more detection coming in from Liquid if he goes for a Shadow Blade.
Yeah.
I don't think Blink Dagger would be such a good choice, but Vladimir's suits the style they play. They just 5-man a lot. They want to be as strong as possible. They already have the Weave. They would have so much armor and mitigate all the Anchor Smash damage, and not to mention the Lifesteer. So all they need to block then is the spells, and then again, the BKB, so they would make a really strong push if they had it.
Liquid coming over to this half of the map as well. Swindles, he just boxed in.
Has to be careful. Right.
Does indeed, just outside of the edge of the vision.
He spots them. And they see the Hawk as well, so they know that at least the Leshrac has been spotted here. A lot of time invested by Liquid.
I was gonna say, this is a huge movement here from the side. Five heroes committed, whereas you look towards the place they are.
Zephyr is walking into it.
And he's still not spent his gold here. Zephyr needs to be careful. I mean, he's going to run, and he's incredibly speedy with the Scorched Earth and the Tranquil sticking back in. He's out.
They in fact saved him with that glimpse. They sent him back, and he was running towards them. So that was a little bit panic click by Jerix on the glimpse.
I mean, Liquid, they still want to find something. They are going to find a very nice Ancient stack.
That is a lot
this
of money.
This is great for Liquid if they get away with this one, but I'm sure Complexity, they'll want to do something about it.
Yeah, Chessy is pretty mad. He has Battle Fury. This is his money, not the Tides. They're going to try and defend this.
Oh, they do feel scared as well. Liquid, look, they've even kind of helped out the side here, bringing them down to half health. And Chessy, yeah, he'll come in.
Oh.
And he'll be able to finish this off. So if anything, Liquid have just helped him at the moment. Unless they can punish him, they need to do something about it straight away. Jumping in, there we have it. Liquid taking down Chessy.
He got everything. Then BKB was used on Limp as well. So that's the 10-second BKB on Prophet. And they managed to clear up the stack. Sure, some of the gold was claimed by the Juggernaut, but you kill him, that's a payback.
That's a big kill for Liquid. And they did need to find something. As you said, they spent a good, at least a whole minute. They're moving around as five across the map.
You know, I just want to take a second to point out an interesting fact. In this game, the 2-5 position supports are the ones who haven't died a single time. That's very rare.
Yeah, I mean, just what Kuroki's and Hansken's positioning.
I suppose that Liquid have two, you know, they have very even form between their two supports. In fact, Crow is a little bit over farm.
Oh, this is really nice for Liquid as well. You know, they find themselves a big kill. They then find the space to just head into the Roshan pit, and nothing the Complexity are going to look to do about this one. So Liquid starting to feel like they're really getting some momentum built up now. And it's got to be a little bit scary for Complexity aside as well. As you said, with this kind of lineup, they're looking to kind of just maintain control of the game from the start.
Yeah, they do. They do have some tools for later on in the game, but I just look at this draft and I feel like you have to take tier 2 towers, you have to start at least breaking a little bit, control Roshan, and if you don't do this, Chessy.
If he gets caught out again here, mind control, gets the gush low, Chessy. Play Fury away and instant TP's here from the side of Complexity to make sure Liquid don't go too ham for that kill.
Yeah, but they have to back up and defend top. This is good, you know. Good play by Complexity.
With this Shadow Blade as well. Let's see what he does with this Windle. With the Ron's Kuroki, Z-Freak is going to look around. Infernal Blade and Doom down onto Puddock. They finish it off. The Chain Frost coming in. Z-Freak's gone. Let's see if he can survive through this one. Chessy's coming as well. In with the Omni Slash Limp now with the BKP, the Exorcism. Complexity are looking to try and take this fight. Siphon onto Doom, but Timmerman, he's gone, but he's got the Aegis. We'll be back around for round two. Limp, Siphon onto Fada, but forced away. It's gonna be okay.
Liquid can chase here if they want to, but they're gonna back out and play it safe instead. Could maybe have gone there. A lot of ulties being used, Omni Slash being down.
I mean, look, they're making a beeline straight back in. Liquid, they do not want this fight to be over. They realize this is a great time, as you said, for them to get stuck back in. Matuma Man trying to move forward, but Complexity, I think they're gonna head to the side and just try and TP themselves out. We'll see if they're going to be lucky with the escape.
The glimpse. Is it gonna get it?
Let's see, they've got the vision. Yep, a vision for the glimpse there. Hansen gets brought back. Will Shallow Grave himself, but he's almost certainly a dead man as the Timmerman chases him down. Finds themselves another kill, and Liquid
just back through the tower, get it now.
And get the push on. I mean, that was huge for Liquid there. We saw that fight Complexity, you know, blowing BKBs, Omni Slashes, Exorcisms. They don't kill anyone on Liquid. They end up having to run away, and still Liquid find kills off the back of it.
It was a little bit of an awkward scenario, having the Doom and the Beastmaster try and kill off Leshrac. When he has his allies around him, the Frost Armor helps him tank up so much. Sure, you have a decent amount of damage, but this is still just a level 1 Infernal Blade. I'm not too sure about that build, by the way. This max Devour is not something we see that often by Doom players, and I really think it hurts the damage output. We're talking 1.25% damage instead of 5%. And the cooldown being so massive.
I mean, with that kind of build, and obviously the way that the Jug's built as well, even though we do see Jug build this in lots of different kind of games with different momentum, do you think Complexity kind of realized at stage that they will just be playing for the later stages of the game here?
I think that's what they're saying. Between going Battle Fury and going for the max level Devour.
Oh, my control jumping in with the Lifestealer Bomb. Swindled.
Getting destroyed. And he already went for Travels, by the way. Level 1 Necrobook into Travels. Definitely gonna take a while for him to finish up the entire Necro 30. He does have 1800 gold, but dying does not speed it up.
Yeah, maybe the early bots was a reaction just the way that Liquid were playing, you know, realizing they were moving around as a five man, so felt that there was always going to be a space for him to feel safe across the map for just that split push and just to continue farming in the opposite location to the whereabouts of Liquid.
It definitely doesn't look safe anywhere on the map with Liquid. I mean, looking for kills all the time.
They are constantly in Complexity's jungle.
No, they really are. They're just moving together to look for fights, and then they have someone farming. Matumba Man getting that creep going, and he has 3,000 gold again here after finishing up a Desolator. This lifesteal is getting really big.
It really, really is. And it's going to be interesting to see how well Chessy can try and scale up against him. He's still 2k behind the net worth. Does have 2k gold coming up on top of the Battle of Fury Bank Up, but he's still got a way to go with his build before he can really hope to deal with this power of Matumba Man's lifestealer. And they're looking for a bit of pressure up top. Complexity will start to force out the TP reactions from Liquid. And in fact, Mind Control jumping forward does have Matumba Man in him. So if they can find anything deep, oh, he's going to come in with the Matumba Man. That's the surprise! Matumba Man jumps out, Static Storm. Chessy's able to walk out to the sidelines, get the healing ward out. Raw control of Matumba Man for the time being, now moving in. Can they bring down this lifestealer with a heal bomb? The axe is flying through, they will get it. Matumba Man's gone and on the back line, with this exorcism moving through. He's taken down two. Ravage will come out, a buyback from Kuroki, but Complexity going full on aggressive against Liquid here, forcing him right back, getting the space for the tier 3. And Complexity now looking to take away the wretch from this top lane. A Liquid Mindstroke cuts in, forces himself back out. There's the fortification buyback from Matumba Man as well. Complexity forcing a lot out of Liquid here. And it doesn't look like Liquid are going to be able to do anything in terms of finding a kill. At the least, they'll keep them off the racks, but that play there from Complexity.
Wow, all the advantage that they had accumulated there in just net worth just gone in one single fight. That was really detrimental for Liquid.
I mean, what went wrong there for Liquid? Was it a mistake trying to go for that kill with just the Lifestealer and Tide at the start?
They were way too optimistic. That's a juggernaut that you're chasing. If you don't have a good way to disable him to start off, then you should probably not chase him because he has allies behind him as well. And there are 3-4 staffs on the side of Liquid, so I understand them wanting to try and chase, but you know, they TP him one by one. They don't have everyone there.
As you said, a real big hitter there for the side of Liquid, and just look at obviously just the comparison between the Jug and the Lifestealer. Suddenly, Jug's at the top, thanks to that last bit of a
massive
engagement.
Massive swing in net worth. So he could go for anything he wants right now, but I think Manta Style would be pretty great for this Juggernaut. And
look in the jungle here. Mind Control, just hanging around.
He doesn't have Ravage, but he gets scouted actually. Yeah.
They will spot him out, and that's trying to make a go on this. Glimpse back on Limp to break the siphon. Mind Control will be able to get himself out. Did have the backup of Liquid.
This hands can dropping a sentry. He's like, oh, is there a ward here? Oh, a tight.
Yeah, 12 for 10. We're 30 minutes in. I mean, yeah, as you said, you know, just the fact that there was that big swing round, you know, Complexity kind of re-grabbing the reins on this game.
And you should definitely not count out Complexity going into a later stage. I think their early game pressure is very strong, but later on they do have Doom, Juggernaut scales quite well, and Dazzle's a great late game support, so they have a few good tools later on. But Ravage and Lifestealer, that can always blow one hero up, and it's a dangerous thing they have to look out for.
I mean, we're talking kind of about the safe lane matchup as the game goes on, but kind of back towards these mids, you know, both the Death Prophet and the Leshrac, you know, two heroes that you said yourself, they do want to try and get the kind of the momentum going at the start and maintain being on top. If it gets to the later stages, who are you happier to have on your team, a farm Death Prophet or a farm Lesh?
It comes down a little bit to what you have for a team. Leshrac is super good here, following up on Disruptor and Tide. So in this scenario, Liquid would much rather have this. But overall, I think DP is a little bit stronger late game.
So if you're Complexity at this point, you feel that they don't really need to go for any kind of aggressive plays. They just need to be ready to react to what Liquid are doing. Because I mean, we've seen the players of Liquid. Liquid, they are going full on aggression. They're constantly looking for action. So you feel like it would be best if you Complexity to just make sure that you don't fall kind of, you know, into this trap that Liquid continues to lay.
Exactly. I think that's very important that you don't get picked off, but at the same time need to push out the side lane. So it does help them a lot that they have the travels on the Beastmaster. He also did go back for the Vladimir's before finishing up the Necro 3 book. And I think this is an interesting play. Necro 1 is quite strong now, so it's quite fine. You know, years ago or patches ago when Necro 1 was really weak, this would be terrible. But you pretty much nailed it, what they need to do here. And Juggernaut did go for Diffusal first, so probably going to go back into Manta Style after that. Going to help his DPS quite a lot.
Absolutely. Looks like we should be able to get the game back underway very shortly here with Chessy getting himself back in. But certainly a close one at the moment, and this is interesting to see as well, because coming into this matchup, I mean, for Seoul, a lot of people would not have expected to see Liquid in the lower bracket. And now, I mean, Complexity, they are really giving them a run for their money. This is by no means looking like Liquid being the stronger team outright.
I think we had some discussion between different casters earlier about this, that Liquid, they have been so amazing lately, and suddenly they're the favorite to win for almost the majority of people watching. And it seems that they were not used to being the big dog, you know? They're always the underdog team and performing so well. Going into this, of course, they're playing pretty well, but they have dropped games against every single series here at the Manila Major. So it's looking tough for them again here in the first game, but this is a three-game series.
Yes. And certainly hasn't been as smooth a run as you said, Liquid have had in previous lands. Gems being picked up by Kuroki. This, of course, could be very nice, especially with the way that Liquid's moving. They are going to be able to get pretty good map control against Complexity, and also just something to help deal with the initiations that the Doom's constantly looking for with the
Shadow Blade.
Exactly.
The Shadow Blade, that's the bigger thing, yeah. Actually, being able to counter this, because when he gets the initiation, dooming off the Tide or doing the Leshrac, That's just going to win a team fight for Complexity. And you see the way that Death Prophet follows up on that. She just runs in, super tanky with the Shivas, Veil, and BKB. She's practically immortal for her BKB duration. It's too much armor to kill her physically.
And looks like we may see Liquid once again look for a bit of a movement. Matsuma Man is geared up inside of Mind Control. And we'll see what kind of movement they make at the same time. Smokes will be picked up from Complexity, so we may see a situation where a bit of smoke on smoke does happen again.
Yeah, definitely looks like Complexity want to go. Yeah, two smokes available on the courier as well.
And it's, of course, yeah, it's getting close to the time that Roche will be back up, so this may be the point where we see the next big fight kick off, unless one of the sides wants to try and push for a pickoff before Roshan's available.
Liquid has the better intel over here as well. They have a deep ward, and they did see everyone there pretty much. And now, smoke coming out, two smokes in fact. Hanskin has them ready, Complexity. Have to be careful in the mid lane here, though.
Liquid have got eyes on it. Of course, this initiation potential from Mind Control and his Tide.
I think the very important thing is Limp going to get his BKB off before the initiation comes?
Yeah.
Or is he not? Because if he gets ravaged and they jump out and immediately start laying into him, he could take so much damage that even Dazzle might not be able to fully save him. And especially if Dazzle gets hit with the ravage, then that is bad times. He's had good positioning though. Both teams playing really safe now. They don't want to die before Roche.
I mean, the only person that's kind of going alone is Swindles on his Beastmaster, but other than that, the rest of his side and the full five man of Liquid just very, very resilient and sticking together as a group, and rightfully so, because we are going to see that Complexity will now use their smoke and start to make a movement. So Liquid need to be careful about this one. Still hanging around by their own ancients.
They're in such good position though to react to this.
Great high ground advantage here if Complexity do come around this corner.
And they're looking to go down mid instead, just trying to find anyone who goes alone. And they're split pushing. They realize that, you know, we can't run into all five of them, that's not going to be a good play. And Roshan being taken here.
This could be a nice one here for Liquid. Complexity over half of the map at the moment. Maybe not too aware that this is going on. At the least, they may look to just try and take the Raxic. Complexity, they are gearing up to go in for a full push on the top lane. But Liquid, they should be able to get the Aegis and get back to defend.
There. He doesn't have an infest and he doesn't have a TP.
No. So they'll be fighting without Matsuma Man if they choose to fight. He's got to take the long, shameful walk back. Already here with the Exorcism, Complexity eating into the racks. Jesse will get caught out by the summon immediately with the Blade Fury backing off, but Complexity get them the melee racks at least, and they're going for more with the Shiva's got the Siphon on Tabata, nearly bringing them down. Montreal goes for the Ravage, but Libby's BKBW will catch Jesse on the sidelines, but Complexity, they don't care.
Now
the Rawls and Matsuma Man, Complexity looking to move in for more. Jane Frost gets laid down, Static Storm cancels off Jesse as well. Jesse's down, they'll find the kill for the Juggernaut. The rest of Complexity need to get themselves out of there. Z-Frig, he's been left behind. Matsuma Man, he's been doomed, but he doesn't care. They'll fight for it. Liquid do claim a double kill, make that a triple, as Hanskin ends up offering himself up to the God of Matsuma Man at the end of that fight. So they get the kills, but still a blunder from Liquid there. Complexity get away with taking the melee racks because Matsuma Man had no way of getting back to base.
Yeah, that was definitely really sad for them, watching him just walk all the way there while his racks was going down. Beautiful static storm roar, and they managed to turn the fight, get three Bloodstone charges. Gonna be, you know, a consolation prize at least. But this is what Complexity want to do, and we've seen them do it before. Just go for push, over push, over push, and then Best Profit is going to be able to seal the game later on, maybe.
Momentum amount early in the zone there. We can see for the goal progression, that nice little spike at the very end, thanks to that last fight, keeping him on top.
And Limp has been really clutch with his BKBs, always getting them on time. Even when the Tidehunter starts going in, he's just reacting so well.
It does have to be a little bit scared of the fact that Matsuma Man is getting kind of, he's going to have more and more damage as this goes on with the way that he's building. He's got a lot of armor, of course, with the Shivas, but still not a huge amount of health pool to play with.
Yeah, when he gets his Octarine, he will be in a great place.
Absolutely.
That really should be his next item as well. It would just be so good for him. And Liquid, they get the top tower. Some more money. His lifesteal is getting really big, but
he really is.
But yeah, he has to be there for fights. That's the only thing.
And someone that's kind of been keeping up as well, really nicely, that we haven't really talked about too much this stage, is Fada. You know, he has managed to maintain control of his Bloodstone charges. He's up to 17. And he's neck and neck, pretty much, with the farmer Matsuma Man. So a little bit of a quieter game, it feels. He's kind of come and done his stuff at the end of the fights. And did kind of, struggle a little bit at the start, but the Lesh is going to be an issue.
Really should say that about Fada as well. He's one of the most stable players.
Oh, absolutely. And oh, look at this. Swindles swagging it off. Goodbye, boys.
Gets away safely. And Fada, he does have his BKB coming in. He has Aegis as well, so they want to keep pressuring here. Try and go for kills.
Eyes onto Chessy. Nice initiation here with a stun and a look for the chase down. But Chessy with the Blade Fury out, just moving himself away, and he'll be able to get the blink off. Manages to make the escape. Liquid still continuing to move up incredibly aggressively. They want to try and find some Complexity blood.
They're using multiple four steps, trying to catch them. Disruptor glimpsed, but can't get close enough. Also doesn't have vision anymore. They get the tower again, though. Two towers in short succession here for Liquid.
And Liquid, they have all the ultimates up, but at the same time, so do Complexity. So we'll see what kind of reaction.
The Infest Tides. It's a very strong bomb, this Lifestealer. And he has the critical strike as well now with the Echo Saber, so it really hurts so much.
Yeah, as soon as he gets a lock onto someone, they are falling in a couple of punches, that's for sure.
Tide has to blink pretty deep, though, to get the Dazzle as well, or at least make sure he can't save anyone.
I was going to say, look at the positioning really of Hanscan. He's just playing it super safe, keeping himself right away. Already just a siphon and a couple of clicks, forcing Limp back. And just looks like Liquid at this stage, just really respecting the power of Complexity's high ground defense and
top lane,
being very careful.
The range racks actually falling here.
Free range racks,
Liquid,
indeed.
Yeah, Liquid not defending to that. Oh,
come on, creeps.
They're going to get it. They're going to win this creep fight, and no one is TPing, so.
Classic, really. Creeps going for kills rather than objectives.
Yeah,
come on.
Look at that. Yeah. That's the 2K MMR play.
Absolutely. Come on, creeps. Step it up. TP back.
Are they in time? It doesn't really matter, though. It's the range racks. 44 HP. You're just going to send one Necrobook or even just the boar on his own could do this. So that range track is pretty much going to die. Juggernaut starting to stack up a lot of money again here with the Blink Dagger and Defusal. His next pickup here could be the Abyssal even. But I still think he should go Mantis Style. If he can get Mantis Style and Abyssal, that's pretty much where he wants to gear cap at.
Oh yeah, if you get the lockdown onto someone, that's a huge amount of damage output.
Would make him very survivable, and also have that reliable lockdown against Lifesteer makes it so that he doesn't just end up being insta-killed if he gets close to him.
That's
a little bit surprised that the Lifesteer went for Crystallis instead of the Vanguard, or Basher into Vanguard.
Yeah, I mean, I guess it's just very good with the Echo Saber. Just having that Echo Saber crit build, it's something that a lot of players do like to get. Just having those two items.
It is a ton of damage.
Yeah.
You see both teams just playing a little bit more safe now. Liquid, they did push out the top lane quite far, but Swindles is on the case, going there.
And it's been a very careful game from both sides. I mean, we've not really seen too many times just someone being caught out of position.
That's what we normally see, though, in the first game in the best of three. Normally, teams are a little bit more careful to see what happens, and then the team who wins will just have a lot more confidence going into the second game, maybe even pull out some pocket strats. So, no surprises at all. We are in lower bracket after all.
Yeah, this is the no messing around indeed. And we are going to see again some smoke on smoke action. Liquid Very close at the moment, Complexity, they're coming around Liquid, looking towards the mid. Complexity, so they're able to catch them off guard. Both sides have all the ultimates available. Mind Control and Matumba Man in him at the moment. Limp, he's going to look to lead the way. The Shiva's guard coming out, so they've got the vision now. Midu with the BKB, Exorcism as well. They're ready to go. Complexity for the turnaround. Matumba Man straight up to see if everybody's kept alive. Hasken keeping him alive here with the Shadow Grave. Bottom moving in with the BKB, the magical damage, bringing Chessy down. They pop two. Liquid moving in for more. Can they catch anything else out here? Looking for Hasken, they'll get the slow from bottom. Matumba Man's going to wrap around. Open wounds are out, and Liquid take down a third. Double kill for the Lesh. A great fight for Liquid there.
Just chasing as well. They have Disruptor. Glimpse is there. Doom can't get away.
Oh man, it looks like they are indeed going to find a forfeit.
Yep, they have the gem as well, so even the Invis is not going to save him. Four dead, not a single buyback. Well, actually, they have a buyback available.
Now, one fight. And the scary thing is, well, that was a fight as well where Liquid did not use the Ravage. They've still got Ravage available on Mind Control. They'll clear out the mid lane, head towards the top. I mean, at the least, they're going to find two full sets of Rector, but with the amount of pushing power that they've got, they may even find more, as you said. No buybacks.
I don't think that you stop here. If you're Liquid, you should just keep going for the game.
A very careful, calculated game, and we're seeing why one fight, and suddenly Liquid just taking everything away from Complexity here. A huge, huge loss in terms of fights there.
Desperation buyback, but you cannot stop Matumba Man right now.
See what they can do with the roar onto Matumba Man. No exorcism though here at the moment for this defense, so it's going to be a hard one. BKB from Fano, they get the stun out. No, they won't. Lint, immediately with the BKB reaction. Looking at Matumba Man, he'll be able to find the kill to Lysia. It's a big one as well. Could completely find anything more.
They
looking to chase
lot.
Them out of the base. They'll drop the Abyssal down. Kuroki will get four stuffed out of this one. Liquid trying to save the man. Again, the force is keeping Kuro alive, but Swindles blinking forward. Can they finish him off the Chain Frost? It will begin to bounce, but Jesse Blade Fury through the power of Disruptor. Trying to chase down Kuroki, but they'll get out one. They won't get out the Lich, though.
Yeah, they managed to get out and save the gem as well with the Tidehunter, so not that much lost for Liquid. Lifesteal Force dying is a little bit painful, but look at that Ranger Axe.
Yeah, the one.
So low.
The last legs here that Complexity have in that base. Half a Ranger Axe.
That's really not good.
Man.
They need to push now and make it work.
They need to pretty much push, win the fight, win the game.
Yeah, this is going to be it.
Let's see what they can do with this one still. You know, Ravage.
They do have the Blink Abyssal.
Let's see what they can do. Oh, going in with the Jarek. Jarek's going to see the
Force
Stop. Liquid literally using the Force here to keep this game alive. And Complexity, what can they do about it? They're going to come in again. Ritual will finish off the Disruptor. Exorcism up onto the Tier 3. What kind of defense can they come out with? There's a buyback from Jarek. Let's see how they can hold this. Four. Now use Chessy, eyes onto Fada.
Oh. Get the Abyssal up.
Oh, this is such a risky bit of play here. Let's see if Liquid can punish it. Complexity get away with the Tier 3. Still 3 seconds, Matumba Man will be back in.
Coming.
Yeah, Complexity, they're scared. Chessy already blinking out. Z-Freak still Shadowbladed up there. Oh, he's got a glimpse back onto Chessy. Chessy, he needs help, he needs backup, but he's not going to get it. Fada punching down onto him with the magical spells.
He gets sold up by his team, but he does have buyback. So there's at least that gonna use it immediately because he knows what's coming. Liquid, they're gonna go down that mid lane.
Swindle's still hanging around here on the bottom. I don't think he's not gonna want to make a play on his own. Immediately heads back. I mean, Complexity, they do force a bit of a reaction out from Liquid. Liquid, they would have loved to have that row. Still about a minute on the timer. We'll see how aggressive Liquid want to go. They know that one more fight, this game is theirs. An incredibly tense moment for both sides here.
Oh, definitely. You have to be so careful if you're Complexity right now. You bought back the Juggernaut. If you get picked off one more time, that's game. But at the same time, they could maybe take the game if they just get one good team fight against Liquid. So many items at the disposal of Liquid, though. These four staffs constantly saving people. Tons of armor with a Lich, just burst arming everyone.
The big window here is the fact that there's 55 seconds without Exorcism. If Liquid can abuse that.
Yeah, definitely. They're gonna go.
And we have it, Liquid.
And how do you really stop this? Lightsteer is gonna be hard. You can roar him, but can you really stop this push?
They need a perfect fight here, Cole. And it's gonna be hard without Exorcism.
Are you
jumping from Mike, the Ravage comes through. Limp will get the BKB off. Swindles bites back straight away. Limp trying to go to work with the siphon. The Jew's been laid down onto the front of the Cole. They're holding for the time. Spin. Roar out onto Matumba Man. He'll actually get forced away from the side here. Fada trying to run in to back him up, but still the Doom's down on him. Digging him down low. Liquid being a bit careful, trying to back up Matumba Man. He's been left alone. He's trying to fight up against Jesse. He's not doing it. Matumba Man stealing the life. The Complexity stealing the game away from them with a triple kill. Liquid may have just done it here in game on. Limbo Z Freak still alive. The only last two remaining members here for Complexity, but the Tumberman gets himself an Ultra. He's not going to be given the pleasure of a Rampage, so not this game. Oh, in fact, okay. Yes, oh, he is. Oh, yes, he's done it. What a nice man. Giving the Rampage similar to my shout out to Z Freak, but nonetheless, a very calculated game from both sides, but at the end of the day, Liquid just with the better team fight and the better execution.
Yeah, just beautiful play all out the game. Just Liquid had so good control with these four steps. Really hard to play Beastmaster against that. You try and roar and lock down on one target, following up with the Juggernaut going in, but if he keeps getting four staffed away and